Okay. Good morning. Can I welcome members of the press and public to the fifth meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2016? Can I first of all ask all those present to ensure that the electronic items are switched to flight mode so that it don't affect the work of the committee? We have a number of apologies today. Apologies from Tavi Scott, Richard Simpson and Colin Beattie. I welcome Sandra White, who's substituting for Colin Beattie, and Mark Griffin, who's substituting for Richard Simpson. As this is Mark Griffin's first attendance at the Public Audit Committee, I invite him to declare any interest relevant to the work of the committee.
Thanks, Kevina. No relevant interest to declare.
Okay. Colleagues, can we now move to agenda item number 2, which is the decision to take items number 6 and 7 in private, that we take all consideration of our legacy paper in private future meetings. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
Now move to agenda item number 3, which is evidence on the AGS report entitled the 2014-15 Order of Scottish Police Authority. I'd like to welcome to our panel of witnesses, which firstly we have Paul Johnson, who's the Interim Director General of Learning and Justice, Scottish Government, John Foley, the Chief Executive, and Andrew Flanagan, the Chair of the Scottish Police Authority, and Philip Gormley, QPM, Chief Constable of Scotland. I understand that Mr Flanagan would like to make a short opening statement.
Good morning, Committee. Thank you very much for the opportunity to say a few words, and I'm going to restrict my opening remarks to the three areas that the Committee gave consideration to in its session last month with Audit Scotland. Firstly, financial controls. I've been a chartered accountant for almost 40 years and I've never before received such a serious audit report. It's important for me to say that I fully accept the recommendations of the auditor and these will be implemented. I do not expect such a report to be repeated and I will do everything necessary to ensure that it is not. I fully recognise the need for improvement and you will hear today how we plan to address that need. Amongst other actions, we've recently appointed an interim Chief Financial Officer, Karen Kelly, to oversee the discharge of the recommendations made by Audit Scotland and other financial matters. The duration of this appointment will be for approximately 3 months. Karen is a former chair of the Chartered Institute of Public Finance and Accountancy in Scotland, and she has more than 20 years of senior public sector finance experience, the last decade with City of Edinburgh Council as its head of financial services and corporate programmes. We've also recently appointed a well-known Scottish firm of accountants, Scotman Creef, as our internal auditors. This appointment was made following a robust public sector procurement process, and we look forward to positive engagement with them in providing assurance on our financial controls and processes. I'm also seeking to use current board vacancies to recruit two senior finance experts as new members as soon as possible. Second point is on the latest financial information and the forecast outturns for 2015-16. Our latest financial information, considered by the SPA earlier this week, shows improvement in the forecast position for the year end since that last reported to the board in December. While this is encouraging, it is not yet fully balanced, and the SPA expects Police Scotland to continue with a rigorous approach to minimising spend until the year end. While acknowledging that there are overspends and underspends across the various funding streams, when considering these in the rounds, this equates to a financial forecast position which is less than 1% from a balanced year-end position. Clearly, there's still further work to be done before the end of March so that we have the best possible position which to start the next financial year and which to build the next phases of police reform and improvement. Finally, the development of a long-term financial strategy for policing by the end of March. The current financial and corporate strategies come to an end at the 31st of March 2016. Those strategies have already delivered considerable financial benefits to policing, and with the level of savings achieved to date, we are confident of achieving the saving target of £1.1 billion by 2026, as set out in the outline business case for police reform. We also now have clarity on the funding for 2016-17. Our financial strategy will be based on delivering a balanced budget next year. The strategy will also demonstrate our assumptions about how to sustain policing over the next 3 to 5 years and beyond that. Our plans will be robust and identify realisable savings and cost reductions in areas like workforce, estate, fleet, procurement and technology that are recurring in nature and which will therefore roll forward into future years. Such evidence will provide ourselves, Parliament and the public with confidence that policing has a realistic and tenable approach to delivering a sustainable police model moving forward. I believe we can deliver these things by the end of March, including a joined-up plan of action which will set out how we can sustain policing through to 2026. And I have seen nothing in my time so far to suggest that the goal of £1.1 billion of accumulated savings is unattainable. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Mr Flanagan. Can I firstly open and just clarify with you for the record that you are would you be the accountable officer for the Scottish Police Authority?
The accountable officer is John Foley, the Chief Executive of the Scottish Police Authority.
So John Foley would be the Chief Executive for that. So perhaps you could clarify then, and would you think it would be a fair statement for me to make, that we would have heard similar commitments from previous Chief Executives and accountable officers in the past? So what makes it any different from what we've heard before? Can you just clarify for the record as well when you were appointed to your organisation? The same for you as well, Mr Flanagan.
Yes, Convener. If I could pick up on that. I was appointed to the Scottish Police Authority in September 2013. In relation to statements being made that we will achieve the £1.1 billion, we are absolutely confident that that will be the case. We have delivered substantial savings to date within policing.
It's not the question I've asked. The question I've asked is, I don't know if you've ever appeared before any of the committees before, Mr Foley.
Yes, but not before the Public Audit Committee.
Yeah, but previous committees, and you would have given them previous commitments to meet the targets that were set by your organisation.
Yes.
So what should we hear today that's any different from what's happened before? And, you know, I take it we've had internal auditors appointed before. I mean, this won't be the first time that you do appointed internal auditors. So what's so different from what's happened previously?
Well, in terms of what's happened previously, we did achieve our financial targets in the first 2 years of policing, and in evidence to committees before, I have made those statements and they have been achieved. As the Chair pointed out, we are still working to look to close the budget for this year, and the work that we have done to date would suggest as we move towards 2026, the recurring nature of the savings achieved to date would mean that we have in the region of 85% of the £1.1 billion in the bag as we sit here at the moment. That would mean that moving forward, if we achieved, for example, £16 million worth of savings in the forthcoming financial year being 16-17, then that would give us approximately 100% of the saving by 2026, and that is consistent with what I have previously reported to Parliament.
So can we get back to the issue of the reporting of the expenditure and income for the organisation, and particularly in relation to the reform funding that's provided to you by the Scottish Government? The Auditor General has highlighted some concerns in connection with the fact that £21 million remains to be unaccounted for, or there are some issues concerning the reporting of that expenditure. Would you expect to write out a cheque to me for £21 million or for me to come back to you and tell you that I've spent it in some context that hasn't been clarified in my accounts?
To answer the question, Convener, there isn't a lost £21 million within the accounts. It has all been accounted for and the balance sheet does reconcile. I believe that the point that the auditor was making is that in the body of the accounts as reported, there was a figure of £21 million which was identified as additional reform expenditure. So by that, it wasn't expanded out, so there was no breakdown of the £21 million, but we do have a breakdown of the £21 million. And that is consistent with the audited accounts.
So in terms of the reporting of it, do you recognise that the reporting of that could have been improved?
Yes, indeed, Convener. I fully accept that that could have been improved within the annual report. And I would like to give a commitment to the committee today that from this year on, all reform expenditure will be broken down in more detail within the statutory accounts to enable the auditor to have more clarification of what the expenditure relates to.
So why wasn't it included in the first place?
The reason it wasn't included in the first place is because it was believed at that point in time that level of detail was sufficient. Clearly, the auditor took a different view on that. The auditor made that clear to me, certainly, and to the authority, and we have accepted that position that the auditor put forward, and we will be addressing that moving forward.
But do you think, though, are you satisfied with the arrangements that were in place to record that expenditure?
I'm satisfied with the arrangements that were in place to record that expenditure. What I would say is that we need to improve the transparency of that information for the auditor and for the wider public.
But it could have been improved before the information was provided in the accounts in the first place.
Indeed, Convener, it could have been improved, and we've taken that as an improvement action, although not specifically a recommendation, but we have decided that it should be treated in the same way as a recommendation, and it will be improved moving forward.
Okay, so can I just come back to you, Mr. Flanagan, in terms of some of the actions that you've set out? Can you confirm when you were appointed as the Chair of the Police Board?
Certainly, I was appointed in September of last year.
Okay, and can you advise us why some of these actions that you've taken forward weren't taken forward before? So, you know, you've advised us of some of the additional financial controls that have been brought forward?
I think some things like the gap in internal audit was a procurement issue and a vetting issue in terms of getting the new team in place.
So what was the gap in internal audit?
The previous internal auditors were PricewaterhouseCoopers, and their period of office came to an end in March. There had been an anticipation that they would continue, but the procurement process throughout that Scott McCreef was a better option. That transition.
Why would they be a better option?
They were more cost effective and had a team that was more responsive to what we were requiring.
In what way would they be more responsive?
In terms of having available people at the right level, that was really the issue. It was the quality of the people that they were offering.
So you can understand our position. You presented this as being a step forward. Yeah. But what you've done is it's been part of the procurement process. There would have been a new auditor appointed anyway. What you're advising is that this is a major step forward because you've appointed a new auditor and the auditor would be more responsive.
Yeah.
So you're advising us that Price, Waterhouse, Cooper Waterhouse weren't being responsive to the police authority?
I don't want to be particularly critical of Price Waterhouse. I think the issue was
that the new organisation, the new auditors that have taken over are going to be more responsive, so you've already done that anyway.
Well, I think the issue for us that when the issue around fixed assets came up, we didn't have an internal audit team that we could put in to investigate the issues, and therefore I think that created a gap which allowed the problems with fixed assets not to be fully addressed. I think if the auditors had been in place at that point, we would have been quicker to respond to the issues, and therefore the delays in the audit, which the Auditor General reported upon, could have been avoided.
By another firm being in place rather than the one that was in place previously?
Yes, because at that point we had no internal audit capacity at that point.
So there was no internal audit that took place previously at all?
No, the internal audit finished at the end of March. The period in which the fixed asset problem began to be identified was through the summer of the year when we didn't have Scott McCreef in place.
So can I just finally then go back before I'm bringing Mary Scanlon to confirm you, Mr. Foley, then? Would it be correct that the Scottish Police Authority didn't have in place an internal audit process? Is that correct?
No, we had in place an internal audit process, Convener, and we did have some internal audit capacity which was internal to the Police Authority, i.e. people who were employees and not members of staff of PricewaterhouseCoopers or Scott McCreef, but those people weren't sufficiently qualified to undertake that work. So if we would have had Scott McCreef in place earlier, I'm sure that we would have...
So do you not take some... So, I mean, can you confirm for the record what your annual salary is?
Yes, my annual salary, Convener, is £110,000.
So it comes with significant responsibility, the role that you have as accountable officer. So do you not take some responsibility for the fact that you didn't ensure that the expertise, particularly in relation to internal audit, wasn't in place to prevent some of the challenges that your organisation faced? Should you not have highlighted that as being a significant area that could have warranted additional expenditure, particularly considering some of the challenges that your organisation have faced really since it was created?
Yes. To answer that, Convener, the issue is that we do have considerable internal resources, both within Police Scotland, primarily in Police Scotland in relation to finance, and some resource financial capacity within the Police Authority. These are qualified accountants, senior accountants, to deal with these matters, so it's not purely down to internal audit. Clearly, I do have a responsibility as accountable officer to ensure that appropriate resources and assets are in place. And that would be the expectation in relation to the fixed asset reconciliations, is that we would have had appropriate resource in place across the organisations. The internal audit aspect of it, of course, is a verification issue in relation to the work that other people have done. And the procurement process did take a little bit longer than we had expected. We started the process in good time, but it did take longer. But yes, I then have responsibility for the procurement process
as
well.
Finally, then summarise this. Possibly the organisation could have seen some losses as a result of that internal audit process not being in place. So if you had the internal audit capacity, then perhaps some additional savings and costs associated with organisation could have been reduced as a result of those internal auditors being in place?
No, Convener, that's not the case, because the issue that presented itself related to fixed assets, and that is not an area where you can achieve savings in relation to that. So there was no impact at all on additional savings potentially being achieved as a result of this situation. It was a situation of reconciliation. It was the implementation of a new fixed asset register that was being put in place within Police Scotland to tighten up the financial controls. That was the principal point of it, but it had no impact on savings.
So good financial management, ensuring that you know where all your assets are located and everything else, doesn't have an impact on how your organisation's organised and doesn't save money?
Yes, good financial management, Convener, of course, overall, does ensure that. However, this problem was specific to fixed assets. The issue that presented itself was that we had effectively 10 legacy systems which were required to bring into one. So there was no single fixed asset register across policing. That was work which was planned to be undertaken within the 14-15 calendar year, albeit the work carries over beyond the 31st of March, which was the expectation. The issue that arose is that the work to take these 10 legacy systems into one took longer than expected and overran. So the attempt was to introduce and tighten up the financial controls. It took a little bit longer than we had anticipated.
Okay. Ms. Gannon.
Yes, can I first of all, I'm looking at changing faces to the ones we've had here before, giving evidence. Can I just ask Paul Johnson how long you've been Interim Director General of Learning and Justice? And can I also ask you how many people have had that job since the merger of our police authorities in April 2013?
Certainly. Good morning. I've been Interim Director General for Learning and Justice since June 2015. Okay. And my predecessor had held that role since prior to the merger of police and of Police Scotland.
So there should be some continuity and some oversight. We can't totally blame these guys. You had the oversight and the direction for the merger and the savings as well. So my first question, for whoever wants to answer it, the last time we had Vic Emery, Sir Stephen and others here, we were given the same promises, Mr Flanagan. I'm delighted to see that you're a chartered accountant, and I hope I retire in a month's time, so I won't be here to follow up on this. But to be honest, we were given all the promises that we've had this morning 3 years ago. So you can understand that there's more than a wee bit of frustration and more than a wee bit of anger when I look at the report we've got in front of us today. And 3 years ago, 2 months after you took up your post, Mr Foley, the Auditor General highly recommended that you have a financial strategy. So nearly 3 years later, you're still promising a financial strategy. So why has it taken nearly 3 years?
I can't account for my predecessor. Personally, as a chartered accountant, I take these kind of matters extremely seriously. It's not just about the role I hold, but the professional standards that I have to behave by. I would say that I have looked at the situation and found that some of it, in terms of what the auditor reported on, is unacceptable. I fully accept what they say, and it is my duty to fix those issues, and I seriously intend to do that. In terms of the accounting records, I think we are in a much better position than we were several months ago. The auditor eventually gave a clean audit opinion in terms of our balance sheet and the fixed assets. I'm satisfied that the new system that Mr. Foley referred to is now up and running effectively, and those accounting record issues should no longer be an issue for the current financial year. In terms of the financial position of the organisation, I think using the auditor's figures, at the end of 2014-15, £122 million of recurring savings had already been recorded and achieved. If those savings are continued through the balance of the period to 2026, and I see no reason why they cannot be maintained, then we would have achieved over 900 million of the 1.1 billion of saving that is expected of us. If I look to what we still need to achieve, it would be a further £16 million of recurring savings each year for the remaining year.
But I think, to be fair, we've covered a wee bit of that ground, but I am keen. It's very important that we look at the figures we have in front of us today. In a letter from the Auditor General to you, Mr. Flanagan, on the 15th of December, she highlights more than once that good governance exists with simple lines of accountability and effective working relationships between key individuals, and that these characteristics have not always been in evidence. Now, we've heard on this committee and also on the Justice Committee and in the chamber of this Parliament that your predecessor and Mr. Gormley, your predecessor, spent their time getting lawyers to work out their job descriptions and to argue what their responsibilities and accountabilities are. Now, this is a letter of the 15th of December where the Auditor General is still highlighting, I think perhaps, Mr. Gormley, you may not have been in office at that time. Can you just confirm how long? Is it 2 months, 3 months?
I started on the 5th of January, so I'm into my fifth week, I think.
5th of January. Well, hopefully things changed on the 5th of January. But I would quite like to hear from you, Mr. Flanagan, as the chair of the Scottish Police Authority, and from Mr. Gormley, that you'll no longer be arguing over your job description, and that the point the Auditor General's raising about clear lines of accountability and good working relationships, good partnerships moving forward, are in place.
I think those things are essential. I fully agree with the Auditor General in those regards. Yes, there were difficulties in the inception of the SPA and Police Scotland about where the demarcation lines of responsibility fell. I think most of that has been sorted out. I've been asked by government to do a governance review to build on the experience of the first 3 years and to make some recommendations. That report is due to the Cabinet Secretary by mid-March, and I'm pleased with the progress that we've made. As part of the recruitment process, Mr. Gormley and I had a number of discussions about how the relationship should work between us and the respective organisations, and I'm satisfied that we will have good relationships going forward.
You don't need to press anything.
Sorry. Thank you. Thank you. Well, I agree with that. I mean, my approach will be to work collaboratively and in a complementary manner to the police authority. In my experience, that's the only way we're going to generate light rather than heat, and I have no view about the past. I'm actively engaged in the governance review on the independence reference group, as are a couple of my senior colleagues from the executive team. So my approach going forward will be to work in an entirely collaborative manner with the authority, recognising that we have different responsibilities. I have no interest in exchanging formal letters with the chairman. I think the relationship needs to be predicated on trust and transparency.
That's fine. I think it's important to get that on the record. It's what we would expect of in any profession. Reading through the annual accounts 2014-15 annual audit of the police authority, I think despite the comments that you're making going forward, Mr. Flanagan, as one of the older members of the committee, you know, as I said, I've heard it all before. When I read last night, a number of misstatements and presentational adjustments were identified. You reported only on the misstatements greater than 90,000, and it's just as well, because we'd probably be here all week. But the misstatements is an error. And the presentational adjustment is putting the numbers in the wrong place. That's pretty fundamental, isn't it? Now, that accounted for an increase in net expenditure of £2.5 million and a decrease in net liability of £13 million. And they also say hundreds of lines in the financial ledger were changed. I've never seen anything like this. I know you're making great promises, but quite a few of you were in place when all this happened. This is public money, and you can't even put your numbers in the right box, and you can't even get your numbers correct. That's pretty damning, isn't it?
I think it's not unusual in any organisation for the auditor to pick up misstatements and for those to be corrected. I didn't... For the size of the audit.
Hundreds of lines in the ledger? Hundreds? Is that normal?
I think part of this remains a struggle in terms of the move from eight legacy forces and eight accounting functions.
You've had 3 years.
I agree that 3 years we should have perhaps made more progress, and I do believe that we can strengthen the financial function within Police Scotland. But I don't think in terms of the overall positioning, in terms of there being some misstatements, is unusual in terms of an organisation of this size. And the numbers themselves are within the context of materiality in terms of a £1 billion organisation.
Well, seems, I'm an economist, not an accountant, but it seems pretty unusual to me. So I'll just ask briefly the further questions. In 2014-15, an overspend of £5.9 million was reported to the board. But it wasn't an overspend, it was actually an underspend. So if you're going to achieve the savings you want, surely you need to be a bit more rigorous. And given that convener's signalling me on, can I just say also in these accounts, the register of interests. Now, I would have hoped that the Police Scotland would set an example to all of us. We've got to obviously fill in our register of interest. 7 out of 12 members had incomplete sections. 5 out of 12 didn't agree with the information held by the SPA. And there was no formal register of interest in 2014-15. That is surely pretty fundamental in terms of governance. That's my second question. And my third one, while I'm here, I was shocked at the National Fraud Initiative. I mean, it seems to me that Audit Scotland had to remind you that that was a task, this is probably for you, Mr. Gormley, but of the process in the National Fraud Initiative, 3,743 records were identified for investigation and 261 recommended. As of the 22nd of September, nothing had been done. So, in fact, what I'm looking at here is that the audit, the figures, the mismatch, etc., is affecting policing in Scotland. We've been very proud of the National Fraud Initiative. We've had a report on this committee about the National Fraud Initiative. But I think if many people out there think that you're languishing about following it up, it's not sending out the right signal. So, three questions.
Let me deal with the conflict of interest and the register of interest. I totally agree that this should be a matter of basic housekeeping and therefore it should have been done. There's no excuse for that.
Please, you will ensure it will
yes,
be done?
It will be done. There's no question.
Mr. Gormley, the National Fraud Initiative, that's pretty poor, isn't it?
I'm not cited on the detail, I'm afraid, so I will go away and have a proper hard look at that in terms of what that means for us operationally and organisationally.
I do believe that Audit Scotland is following it up. And how does an underspend become an overspend? How can you ensure that doesn't happen in future?
Could I follow up on
page 14 of the accounts?
Yes, on some of these points, just to provide more clarification. Yeah. In relation to the declaration of interest, that has now been addressed. We set up a separate governance unit within the authority to make sure that items like this are covered off. So, as we sit here at the moment, that is something that is in place.
Isn't that a bit embarrassing that the Auditor General has to tell you how to fill in your declaration of interest? Is that not a wee bit embarrassing?
Well, yes, it is actually, and that's one of the reasons why we have revised our internal governance structures, as I say, to put that in place. So that is actually has been dealt with. In relation to the National Fraud Initiative, that too is being addressed. That's a point well made also. And I believe that meetings took place last month in relation to that, and that will be something that's addressed moving forward. The capacity.
So that's 9 months after it was after 3,743 records were identified. 9 months later, you're having a meeting.
Well, additional capacity has now been put in place to address that moving forward as well. So, so that will be addressed.
Thank you. Good morning, panel. Just a couple of quick questions. I'm just going to touch upon a couple of the points from the report. Page 2 it highlights under the financial management and the sustainability the issue of the cash overspend. On page 3 under Outlook, it states that there has been prolonged interruption in the delivery of internal audit services. Page 7, paragraph 8, the draft accounts are incomplete and have been subject to substantial revision. On paragraph 10, there was a failure of a senior member of management to take ownership of the fixed assets transition. And then page 21, paragraph 37, there are tensions in such arrangement. That's regarding the time it was taken to allocate and appoint staff to the two finance functions. Clearly, the situation that has that's taken place over the course of the last year has been quite appalling in terms of the internal controls, and we have already have heard a fair amount this morning from yourselves in terms of you fully accept that there have been problems and this will not happen again. But genuinely, mate, what assurances, what guarantees will you provide this committee that in this time, in 12 months' time, whoever's sitting at this table questioning yourselves when you do come back in after a further Audit Scotland report, that we are not going to be going through the same process again, please?
I think if I take the points, the auditor also said that, with the exception of fixed assets, a number of improvements to internal control had already been achieved, and the only concern was related to fixed assets. As Mr. Foley has explained, we were in the process of bringing together 8 fixed asset registers into one, and I think that that did not go well in terms of what happened. I think it was exacerbated by trying to put through a revaluation of fixed assets at the same time as trying to complete the annual accounts, and that made it difficult for both the staff and the auditor to get a proper reconciliation of the fixed assets. We're confident that that was achieved completely to the auditor's satisfaction, and that allowed the auditor to sign off the accounts for last year, and therefore we see that now as a solid foundation in terms of moving forward, and accounting for fixed assets should be one of the simpler aspects in terms of moving forward now that that reconciliation is complete, because actually there's not that many transactions in any given year in terms of additions or disposals. So I'm quite confident that in terms of accounting records, we have made significant progress even in the last few months. In terms of the ownership and responsibility at a senior level. I think that was one of the reasons that I concluded that we needed to have a single point of leadership in the interim period, and that was why we decided to appoint a chief financial officer. And I think we already see some benefits, even though she's only started very recently, in terms of making sure that that coordination between the two organisations is in a much better position.
Okay. On page 24 of the report, there's an exhibit at the top left-hand corner, and two of the boxes I found genuinely very interesting. The first of them was when it states arrangements for the prevention and detection of fraud and corruption require strengthening, and it then goes on to talk about the next box, there has been prolonged interruption in the delivery of internal audit services. Now, we have already touched upon the internal audit earlier on this morning. But in terms of the fraud and corruption require strengthening, I'm keen to learn about what you plan to do about this particular area so that this situation doesn't arise again next year.
Yes, in some ways that goes back to the previous point in relation to the National Fraud Initiative. We have taken steps to increase capacity across both organisations to deal with that, and that will assist with addressing that particular issue.
Okay, on page 29, paragraph 80, it's regarding this, just as it follows on from that point, how many additional people are you bringing in to deal with this particular situation regarding the National Fraud Initiative?
The capacity that we have increased will not be in the form of additional people. It is increasing the quality of individuals over the people that were there before. So as an organisation, we are moving through a period of clearly reform, where individuals have left the organisation on a voluntary basis, and occasionally, and it's only very occasionally, we need to appoint new people to strengthen in particular roles. And an appointment was made towards the end of last year, which will assist with that process.
So is it, in terms of trying to deal with this area, is it really just about, is there any additional training being offered to existing staff as well to assist them?
In terms of an additional training requirement, it's not something that the existing staff are picking up. It is an additional resource, so it's a system which is fairly basic. It's not something that requires a great deal of training.
Okay. Okay, my final question, convener, is regarding the community planning partnerships. It's page 33, paragraph 97, where it states many CPPs are still not clear about what they are expected to achieve, and there's confusion over whether the focus on community planning should be more on local needs or delivering national priorities. Now, certainly it could be argued that that particular paragraph and the issue of the CPPs should be discussed in more detail at the Local Government and Regeneration Committee as compared to here, but obviously the Police Scotland do have an important part to play in community planning partnerships, and I've got a huge level of involvement there. In terms of your own opinions and views, do you think, is that an accurate statement, and do you think Police Scotland should actually have a further input into CPPs at local level, or do you think that the general direction of CPPs is unclear, as the Auditor General highlights?
This is an issue that's come up through my governance review in terms of the workstream on local community involvement. A lot of local authority responses to the consultation document have focused on the issue of the local scrutiny boards, and that being the primary focus of Police Scotland's engagement at a local level. A basic thrust of many of the contributors to the review has been that we must take a much wider view, including community planning partnerships, in terms of that engagement, that it's too narrow a focus through the scrutiny boards themselves. And I would expect to come forward with recommendations on that issue in terms of my review when it's published in March.
Okay. Have there been any particular themes up to now that you're able to inform the committee of that certainly have come out of the information that you have received.
Yes, I think that there's clearly some variability in terms of engagement, in terms of Police Scotland with local scrutiny boards, in terms of past experience over the past 2 to 3 years. There is a need for a more responsive approach from Police Scotland in terms of the kind of national services that they provide through their specialised crime, which is organised on a national level, but actually in reality is delivering services at a local level. Too much of the focus is through the local divisional commander from local policing. So there's one issue for us in terms of engagement with those specialised services into the local community. The second thing is that where there are differences of opinion between the local scrutiny board and Police Scotland, there is no method of resolution or escalation of those issues, and we need to more formalise those approaches and to involve the SPA as and when necessary if there is no agreement between the two organisations.
I support all of that. In the early conversations I've had, not within the governance group, to be fair, but with two or three chief executives of local authorities in the last 3 or 4 weeks, I think there's work to be done in terms of us as an organisation, Police Scotland, explaining the impact and the rationale for national decisions on local, both directly with local authorities, but also making sure that we internally we're connecting up and enabling our divisional commanders to influence national decisions as effectively as I think we need to.
Good morning, gentlemen. I'd like to start, if I may, by just looking at what Mr. Flanagan described as two finance functions. Can I say, I think we're probably both old enough to have put numbers in columns in ledgers and things in our time in pencil. I can't help the feeling that the SPA, which is, what, 2% of turnover or something, would have those days have been one single column in the cash book and another one in the capital ledger. So I'm struggling to see in the context why they really are two separate financial... I know structurally they have to be, but surely they really are... The SPA is surely a very, very small subset. And you might need two finance directors in name. Why on earth do you now need a third one to sort that out?
The SPA fund finance function consists of two people, and that therefore, yes, you're absolutely right, it is a very small function, and it's there for review, analysis and assurance. Personally, my own view coming in is that there should really only be one finance function. Everything that the SPA needs can be provided from a single function. My issue is not so much with that structural separation. My issue is that we need better and improved information flows so that the board of the SPA can make a proper assessment of the financial position of the organisation. And it's that needs clarification rather than a structural issue around finance organisations.
Okay, we're obviously in roughly the same place. Can I then, and I'd like to spend a bit of time, if I may, convene, thinking about the structure of the board and the governance of what's going on. From the perspective of everybody around the table, if I may, the Auditor General makes some comments about the Audit and Risk Committee. I'm sure those structural points will not have eluded you. But can I ask, perhaps, can I start with Mr. Johnston, actually? What does the organisation of the police look like as far as the government is concerned? Where are your lines of communication? Where are your points of information? Where is your influence that's not necessarily controlled?
Well, what we have put in place is an overarching structure for governance and accountability in relation to policing. And there's a detailed document which can be shared if you'd find it helpful to see it, which sets out quite clearly respective roles and responsibilities, those which sit with the Scottish ministers, which includes the financing of the service, the setting of overarching strategic priorities, those which then sit with the police authority, which in particular includes that governance and accountability of the police, and then of course the detailed responsibilities that sit with Police Scotland. So we have the structures in place, we play a very active role working with both the police authority and Police Scotland to ensure that those structures are actually working in practice.
Looking at a situation which we've got, which is a small projected overspend, so let's recognise that it's relatively small, but nonetheless it's significant sums of money. What are you, as the director of this, doing to and with them to try and change that?
A range of things are taking place at present. Personally, the Chair and I meet regularly in order to take stock of the progress that's being made in relation to both SPA and Police Scotland. And members of my team have got very regular engagements with finance leads within both SPA and Police Scotland to work through the detail of the numbers. We will seek to support and advise SPA and Police Scotland as they work through a range of options for the delivery of financial savings, and we also have got an oversight function in relation to reform funding. There's a decision-making function there that the government exercises, and we will seek to ensure that reform funding is used in a way that most effectively secures long-term savings from police reform.
Right, thank you. Then can I come to the SPA and ask you about the committee structure? Because if I can pick up on what Mary Scanlon's just been saying, she was here 3 years ago, I wasn't in the seat 3 years ago. All the things that the Auditor General has been reporting happened on somebody's watch, and the watchers included these committees of the board who don't seem to have achieved very much in getting some of this corrected. So I'm wondering if you could explain to me how that's supposed to work, please.
The committee structure is relatively conventional, so that we have an audit and risk committee and we have a finance and investment committee with what I would see as relatively conventional responsibilities. Where I think there are issues is that, as I touched on in my opening remarks, we have not had the depth of financial experience on those committees or on the board as a whole that I would have expected for an organisation of this size. Some of that's because previous members, the chair of the audit committee, for example, had a long-term health condition and had to step down and was only replaced in April of last year. But I would still go to the point that around my board, apart from myself, and I was only appointed in September, I only have one person who has an accounting qualification on the board. For an organisation of our size, I don't find that sufficient in terms of populating both a finance and investment committee and an audit and risk committee.
Can I absolutely agree with you? Can I ask how it was we got to that position? It was before your time.
Structurally,
how do we get to a point where the board, we've got 12 board members or whatever it is, and only two people actually understand how to deal with the numbers? That doesn't sound like good governance at any level.
I think originally the composition of the board stressed skills from the local authority police boards and experience of that to help manage the transition. I think that was probably reasonable at the time. I think that in terms of looking at it now, and again, this is something I'm considering as part of the governance review, I'm looking at the committee structures and doing it from an entirely fresh skills-based approach in terms of what we need around the table. And I'm recognising that gap exists and moving to address it as quickly as possible.
Can I just ask the new Chief Constable, forgive me the shorthand. Mr. Gormley, I appreciate you're very new to this, but what does this look like to you? Because you've seen these structures of one sort or another elsewhere, of course, in your career.
The structures look familiar. I don't want to rush to a judgment because this is a different context, but the way the committees are structured, the sort of responsibilities, the accountabilities that they have, look to me rational and familiar. As to the quality of the composition of those, that's clearly a matter for the chairman, and he's described some of that. So from the Police Service of Scotland's point of view, the structures look sensible, and I think we can probably support them. I think the issue going forward is that we need to make sure that we are collaborating and being complementary to these, and you know, some of the history of this appears that that may have been an area for improvement.
Yeah, but if you and your colleagues, of course, you cannot conceivably be everywhere doing everything, so I recognise you have a staff team, as you would need. Do your colleagues have confidence in the team with whom they have to operate for what is effectively their finance and rations?
I think there's relationships that are building very quickly, is my experience in the last 5 weeks. The governance review, I think, is the route through that. There's very active engagement between us in Police Scotland and the police authority to make sure that there's some co-creation here. We're ensuring that our own governance reviews are proceeding in a way where we end up with a three-pin plug and a three-pin socket. These need, as I say, to connect properly. So I'm optimistic.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you.
Colin Keir.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to you. I congratulate you on your appointment, Chief Constable. I think a number of things I was looking to ask have already been brought forward. There are a couple of things, obviously, just to be on the record, I'm sure life would be an awful lot easier if you didn't have to be the one organisation in the UK that had to pay VAT. And 26 million quid would come in quite handy, I should suspect. However, one of the things that's been bothering me really since I've read the various reports, and it's in terms of the pension liabilities, which comes through actually on page 11 on this document that we've got here. 20% increase in the overall pensions liability. Obviously, you know, you have a reasonable idea of what your pension liabilities are going to be over the coming years. But was this known, and how was it identified, and quite frankly, how do we get around it? How did we get into this position?
I don't think that the police pension fund is in any other situation than most public sector pension funds, that they're impacted significantly by reducing discount rates, which is pushing up the liability, and also by increased longevity in terms of life expectancy. And that's impacting on all pension funds around the public sector. Policing, and we are not, as Police Scotland, entirely in control of this situation because it's done on a national UK level. But there have been steps taken to try to reduce pension obligations by extending the amount of years that people have to serve in terms of moving it from previously 30 years, I believe it's up to 35 years now that the service has to be before you get full pension rights. Now that has a mitigating effect, but compared to issues like the discount rate and longevity, it's not offsetting entirely the increases that we're seeing.
Could I just take that a little bit further? I do understand you're not dealing with the management of this and whatever, but it's something I have brought up with the Auditor General in the past, and it's the linkage between the UK and the Scottish schemes as the way that this is set up for officers and whatever. A bit unclear about how that actually works. I mean, because obviously in terms of manpower south of the border, if it was a case of there was a linkage between the two sets of pensions, if you have a situation whereas down in my understanding is south of the border there is a decreasing amount of officers in service, this would obviously come through in terms of the overall pot, although it's managed, I understand, the SPPA here in Scotland. I'm just a bit unclear as to the management of this. How does this actually work? Because if there is a linkage with UK, then that could have fairly serious consequences to anything that's managed here, would it not?
I think you're right to indicate that pensions liabilities are significant, and indeed, as you're aware, the Scottish Government has prioritised the maintenance of very high police officer numbers, and indeed there have been very significant reductions in England and Wales. The figures that I've got indicate that had a similar approach been adopted in Scotland as in England and Wales, there would be around 2,900 fewer officers in Scotland. So, of course, that does have a knock-on impact on pension liability, but I should also make clear that those liabilities are paid from Scottish funds separately to the funds that are allocated to the Scottish Police Authority year on year. So if you look at the draft budget documentation, in addition to the SPA's funds, which of course have been protected for the next financial year, but in addition to that, there is a separate figure of, I think, somewhere in the region of £350 million for the payment of police and fire pensions.
So I'm just to be absolutely clear, because I'm not qualified in any shape or form in pensions and stuff like that. Historically, and with the changes that have happened, there is no danger to the pay. This is just what's happening in Scotland here that's affecting this. And what happens with the decreasing amount of money being put into the general pot, that isn't going to have an effect on Scottish pensions.
Well, there is no. I would want to be clear that there is no risk to the payment of pensions in Scotland of our police officers and our Scottish Fire and Rescue Service officers. The arrangements for the payment of those pensions are for the Scottish Government, not for the UK Government. So while there have been schemes, and indeed are schemes that operate across the UK, the responsibility for payment is a matter for the Scottish Ministers, and as I say, separate provision is made to ensure that that payment is made in full, and indeed the administration of that is a matter now for the SPPA.
Yes, just trying to get the fact that overall, is there a risk that we end up over, the Scottish Government ends up having to pay more because of what's happening elsewhere?
I think there's a risk that the Scottish Government is paying more because of what is happening elsewhere. I think there is a significant liability, partly in light of very significant officer numbers, but those costs are being fully met.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning, gentlemen. I wanted to take you back to the financial management and sustainability part of the Auditor General's report, at page 19 in paragraph 32, and perhaps a bit like Colin, I would like a wee bit of clarification or explanation. It's to do with the high level of cash and cash equivalents held. And in the report, it mentions that the SPA held £93 million, which is a high balance of cash and cash equivalents. At the year-end 2013-14, £83 million was held. Could you clarify for me exactly what that means, cash held? It's obviously different from the previous one you were talking about, where you accepted the Auditor General's recommendations to do with assets. So just for someone who's doesn't that familiar with this, what does it mean, cash held?
Essentially, that refers to the amount of physical cash that the authority would be holding in bank accounts at that particular point in time.
And the Auditor General said it's exceptionally high and really no need for this amount of cash to be held. Can you explain why? I see in the recommendation or the management's response, you mentioned that you're undertaking fortnightly cash flow reviews. Do you accept that that's exceptionally high?
It is a high figure. It's not to any great detriment, or any detriment at all to the authority. What we're doing now is we have made moves to try and improve what we would describe as the cash flow management as we move through a year. So we effectively, when the forces came together, the legacy forces, we inherited large cash reserves, and so the move would be to try and reduce that that amount of cash held. It doesn't have a major impact at all on the organisation, but I would accept the point that the auditor makes. It's an accounting issue.
An accounting issue. Yeah. But the Auditor General mentions about grant aid is provided to match the recipient's cash needs. Does it have a knock-on effect on any way of borrowing, as far as I can see? If you're wishing to borrow against, if you had this as a cash equivalent?
I don't think it's got any impact on borrowing whatsoever. Certainly, from a government perspective, we accept the comments made by the Auditor General, and we're expecting the Scottish Police Authority to work through all of these issues, of which this is one, but I don't understand it to have any particular negative impact on our overall accounts.
It's actually more of a timing issue in terms of it's a fixed point in time. You take a snapshot of what you've got in the bank, and then, you know, a week later, a month later, that figure will be different, and it could be significantly different. So I think the issue is that as we move towards a financial year-end position going forward, that we try and rationalise the amount of cash reserves that we actually hold at the 31st of March. So it's a timing issue, really.
It's just that the Auditor General's recommendations and comments mentioned that holding this amount of cash in advance puts unnecessary strain on the public sector borrowing requirement. That's part of the Auditor General's recommendations. So I'm a wee bit confused when you say it doesn't have any impact at all. And is this the norm then, that you would hold this amount of cash equivalents in a bank, such as £93 million?
I think it's worth noting that a very high proportion of the SPA and Police Scotland's cost base is payroll. Something like 90% of our costs are staff related, and therefore there is very immediate payment needs in terms of, for example, national insurance or PAYE that has to be passed over to HMRC very shortly after the end of a month in terms of that. And therefore, it probably, compared to some other organisations, it may look very high. I think there's always a need for us to make sure that that is minimised, and I think that's what the Auditor General is saying, that we perhaps have been too generous in the amount of cash allowance that we've got. Clearly, at some point, when it's consolidated into government borrowing requirements, then it may have an impact. But the cash management of the government as a whole would be a matter for Scottish Government. And I think they would be encouraging us to trim down the amount that we need to hold in reserve. But as I say, the very short-term nature of the payments that we're making will contribute to that being quite a high figure in any event.
Could I just... if you don't mind, could I just, you know, you mentioned in your comments there, it could have an effect on borrowing, and you've been encouraged not to hold as much cash in reserve. So can you clarify that? Because earlier on you said it didn't have any effect. So could you clarify what you're saying? I mean, basically, because the Auditor General obviously said it puts unnecessary strain on the public sector borrowing requirement, and you just said that it could have an effect, and the Scottish Government would be encouraging you not to have as much cash in reserve. But you don't seem to accept that in the action plan and the comments you've just made.
I think in terms of this may be an issue more about where the money is sitting. If it sits with us rather than sitting with Scottish Government, that doesn't change the borrowing requirement per se. The money is still there. The question is whether or not, if we can say to Scottish Government we need to hold less, that at some point along the chain, could they actually manage to squeeze a few million pounds out of the borrowing requirement? Possibly, yes. But equally, we don't want to be in a situation where we can't meet our responsibilities in terms of paying payroll or paying HMRC. So there's a balance to be struck here.
Yeah. So the balance would either be positively on either your side or the government side. You mentioned the fact about maybe squeeze a few million. What did you mean by that?
Well, I think it said in the auditor's report that it had gone up from 10 million the prior year, and therefore maybe that's where we could look to see if we could squeeze that down back to the levels previously. Clearly, as we have been reducing our cost base and squeezing out particularly payroll costs, maybe there is some opportunity there to reduce the amount of cash that we hold.
So if you reduce the amount of cash from 10 million to, say, 4 million, that 6 million would be back into the government.
Yeah. It would sit with government, and they would have to put that together with all the other cash positions that they have from their own spending and decide whether or not that ultimately reduces the net borrowing requirement that they have.
So it does have an absolute direct effect on the net borrowing requirement, regardless whether it's your net borrowing or the government's. So therefore, if you trim that down, the government would have more monies within its coffers, as you might say, than sitting in a bank account topping up to £93 million.
It would have more money available. Whether or not it could actually use that money to reduce the borrowing requirement would be a matter for them to look across the whole horizon of their spending needs.
Clearly, there is a timing issue about when payments are made to the police authority. My suggestion would be that we continue to work on this issue and could certainly provide a written update to the committee on it. I would want to be very clear about what our guidance is on how much cash should be held by the police authority at any particular period in time, and I don't have that figure in front of me, but I'm happy to follow that up in writing if that would assist.
Yeah, thank you very much, Kavina.
Thanks, Kavina. Just to... go over the issue of transparency of reform funding that the Cumhair touched on earlier. Mr Johnson, the government provided £67.5 million for reform. The Auditor General's report flagged up that it wasn't clear what £21 million of that budget was spent on. That's a third of the budget that the Scottish Government provided for reform funded. Did you share the concerns of the Auditor General?
Well, let me say a little bit about how the reform funding is managed in the first instance. So it is indeed funding that is held initially by the Scottish Government, and we receive detailed bids and supported by business cases from the Scottish Police Authority, who work with Police Scotland, and they make a case to us for the most effective use of that reform funding. We consider that internally and disburse funding on a case-by-case basis. And as you see from the accounts, much of that funding goes to pay things like early severance, and indeed, as Mr Keir has mentioned, a significant amount of it goes to pay VAT, and you'll be conscious that that's an issue which Scottish ministers continue to engage with UK ministers on. But it is the case that the £21 million was referred to in global terms in the accounts, and a more detailed breakdown was not provided in the 14-15 accounts. I agree absolutely that moving forward, that more detailed breakdown should be provided. But I would want to assure the committee that it is available, that those in my team who are dealing with reform funding can absolutely see the use that has been made of all of that reform funding. I can go through some of the various ways in which it was used in 14-15, if that would be helpful, or again, if it would be helpful to follow that up in writing. I can absolutely do that. But I'd want to assure the committee that there is, that from a government point of view, we are very clear about how the reform funding has been spent.
Okay. Thanks.
It was just a supplementary to Sandra White's question, and I don't know if it's Mr Johnson that wants to answer or not, but I wonder if I can seek a bit of clarity, because I do find it quite confusing that you have a funded local government pension scheme which is run by 8 separate local authorities, and then you have 2 separate unfunded schemes, the police pension scheme and the new police pension scheme. And if that wasn't okay, I've sort of glanced over it, but further down in paragraph 44 of the Audit Scotland audit, it is stated that we would have expected this project to have featured in the risk registers. How complex is it to have 1 funded and 2 unfunded schemes, and looking at a background of serious financial constraints to local authorities? So how complex is it, and is there a risk going forward with this scheme? And can you perhaps just explain to me if the 8 local authorities are still running this funded scheme? Because I'm kind of struggling to get my head around the operation of it.
Yeah, I'm not hugely familiar with the detail, but what I think is the issue is that police staff and support staff would have been in the pension schemes of the local authorities to which their police body was originally allocated, and that those arrangements would continue in place rather than creating a new pension fund for Police Scotland support staff. And I think that's probably simpler because it avoids the trying to transfer liabilities from existing pension funds into new ones.
So serving police officers, were they never in the local government-funded scheme?
No.
They were in their own scheme?
Police officers. Would be in the UK national schemes. Those are unfunded schemes.
Yes.
And the fact that there are two will reflect the change in the length of service arrangements, that it's easier very often in terms of major changes to pension conditions to establish a new scheme looking forward and to preserve the benefits in the old scheme for those members that
so
already have
So the police pension scheme is the UK one and the new police pension scheme is the Scottish one, is that right?
The changes to the terms of the pensions in terms of extending length of service apply to all UK police officers. It wasn't just a Scottish change.
But I'm sure you appreciate that it must be quite complex having three separate pension schemes, given that we're looking at better collaboration and working together. And it's just when the Auditor General says she would expect this to be on a risk register.
Yes, and I would agree with the point about it being on the risk register. I think that is an omission. However, again, because the pension schemes are managed by, in effect, other parties,
yeah.
One could have a debate as to whether the risk is sitting with ourselves in terms of pension liability or whether it sits with central government. I think that's potentially why it wasn't being flagged on our risk register. But my own preference would be to have it signalled, even if we are managing it through a relationship with other parties.
Yeah. It's just convenient. So you feel that having three pension schemes is a workable solution and brings security to members of staff going forward?
I think it's better for the members of staff that they are in the original pension schemes they were in. I think that preserves their benefits in the long term in a much more effective way. Trying to unpick those arrangements simply for administrative ease, I don't think that would be the right course of action.
Good, thank you.
Can I just ask a final question, Mr. Foley? So as you've confirmed, you are the accountable officer and you have been since 2013. So looking at the annual audit report which is carried out, I take it that you are personally responsible for ensuring that the action points in the document are implemented. Is that correct?
Indeed, Convener, that is my personal responsibility, yeah. And I would like to assure the committee that the actions have been taken on board. We have an audit action plan which is in place, and all of these actions will be delivered and reported back through the authority and back to Audit Scotland.
And you've been responsible for the previous three audit reports since 2013, is that correct?
Since 2013-14, yes.
Yeah. So, if I referred you to paragraph 9, page 15 of the current report, 2014-15, it says here, members' expenses, and it says, we recommend that 2012-13, that the members' expenses policy and procedures be reviewed and updated. And it says here, despite being agreed by the management, this has not been done in 2013-2014-15. So you're personally responsible for ensuring that that's updated. Why wasn't it updated?
It was not updated to the standard that I would expect it to be updated. It was updated. We do have now...
So tell me about... this is headed here, members' expenses. So maybe for the benefit of the record, can you confirm that this is referring to board members?
Yes, this is referring to board members.
So it says here that members worked above the recommended 10 days per month.
Yes.
As per the Scottish guidance, some claiming 20 days per month.
Yes.
That was going on for 3 years. And you are personally responsible for ensuring that the recommendation that was set out by Audit Scotland wasn't carried forward. So, you know, again today, what kind of assurances can we receive from you? You advise us that this will be carried through. This appears to me be a very basic requirement of you to ensure that this guidance is updated, but members continue to claim 20 days per month?
The procedures have been updated, Convener, in relation to how members' expenses are claimed, and they are rigorously applied now.
I'm not asking you need to be fair to respond to the question I've raised, though.
Yes.
The question I've raised is, You were personally responsible for ensuring that this recommendation set out by Audit Scotland said that you should update the guidance so that members were clear what the requirements were placed on the board members. So some board members claimed 20 days when the guidance was 10 days. Sounds pretty basic to me. So why didn't you ensure it was implemented? That's a straightforward question. Yeah.
At that particular point in time, the issue over the member who claimed 20 days, that was at the discretion of the then chair, Vic Emery, and that was for a specific piece of work which was associated with the Commonwealth Games.
You were asked here, but the Auditor General set out that there's a requirement. You said you would update the policy. So didn't you update it to ensure it met the Scottish Government's guidelines? That was your responsibility, not the chair of the organisation. You're the accountable officer.
Yes. The policy was not updated to the exact standards that it should have been, and I accept responsibility for that.
So what would the cost to the organisation have been? I mean, what is the cost per day of a board member's claim?
Well, the cost to the organisation would be £300.
So £300 per day. So if we're talking about 10 days, then it's £3,000 per month. So there's members claiming above that amount by £3,000 because you didn't have in place the recognised guidance?
Well, no, the guidelines were there. They weren't being applied.
So why didn't you ensure they were applied, though? You're the accountable officer. Not the board chairman, not the finance director, not the chief constable. You are personally responsible for ensuring. You've just advised me of that from the very outset of our questions here.
Yes.
You've confirmed that you're the accountable officer, and you've been the accountable officer for ensuring that this very basic recommendations carried through. So you take full responsibility for that, don't you?
Yes, I do. Absolutely, yeah. Convener.
So do you think you should be concerned that you haven't met a very basic requirement of you, considering the significant responsibilities that are placed on you? So if you can't get this very basic recommendation from Audit Scotland correct, then what confidence can the Audit Committee have in you, given what's the annual expenditure of Police Scotland?
It's £1 billion, Convener.
£1 billion. So
yes.
You're responsible for £1 billion. You have a very basic recommendation placed before you here of ensuring that the expenses of the board meet the Scottish Government's guidelines. They've not been met. So do you think we should have any confidence in you that you're spending £1 billion and you can't get this very basic recommendation correct? You understand the position that's been presented to you?
Yes, I do, Convener. And the answer is yes, I do believe that the committee should have confidence in me. As I said at the outset, we have had significant financial challenges to meet over the last 3 years. We have met those challenges in the first 2 years of the Police Authority and Police Scotland, and we are looking to meet those challenges as we move into this year. The point you make is accepted that policy should have been tightened up.
You said
it wasn't, and I take responsibility for that.
Can we just go back here, though? You said one board member. Says here we found that many board members worked above the recommended 10 days per month. How many board members worked above the recommended amount?
I don't have that information to hand, Convener, but I'm perfectly willing to provide that in writing to the committee.
So was the review not carried out that perhaps, and I'm not sure whether Mr Johnson wants to come in on this, that perhaps the funds should be recovered, given that it was above the Scottish Government guidelines, Mr Johnson?
Well, as Mr Foley has said, the process involved the chair approving the claims made by Police Authority Board members.
Now, do you find that acceptable?
Well, no, the process itself has been followed in that the chair had discretion as to whether or not to approve those claims, and there's been no suggestion made to me that any members were claiming for work that they had not done. So I'd want to make a distinction between two things here. One is whether the board members were putting in legitimate claims for work that they had done in furtherance of their responsibilities, and the answer to that is yes. The second is whether the government was satisfied with the overall level of claims that were being made, and the answer to that is no, we were not. And
so
we
why did you allow the claims to be paid then?
Well, we allowed the claims were paid on the basis that they related to work that had been incurred and approved by the chair, and that was the chair's responsibility to either approve or decline payment. But in relation to the overall issue of the number of days worked by board members, that has been subject to a clear guidance from the Scottish Government, which actually has now brought down the number of days and has tightened the approval process.
Let's just go back to this again, though. You would be aware, well, I take it that the Scottish Government would have been aware of the recommendation in the document from Audit Scotland, which was first highlighted in 2012-2013, is that correct?
Yes,
it says here, we recommended in 2012-13 that members' expenses policy and procedures should be reviewed and updated. That's correct, isn't it?
Yes.
So the Scottish Government would have been made aware of that. So would you not have expected the Scottish Government to say, we're not allowing these payments to be taken forward because it's in our guidelines that it should be a maximum of 10 days per month?
Well,
so
we
what,
have...
So what, what role did the Scottish Government civil servants play and ensuring that this was carried out properly?
The government's the civil servants have been working closely with the police authority throughout this period on the issue of members' expenses. I would want to highlight that it was a recommended 10 days per month limit, and at points the case has been made around the very heavy workload and the onerous responsibilities that police authority members have, particularly in that transitional period following reform, where there was a heightened number of meetings and amount of work that were expected to be made. So we accepted that there were cases where the number of days would be more than the normal threshold. But as I say, that has been the subject of ongoing work and now has been subject to a new instruction from ministers around the maximum numbers and the process for making claims.
Mr. Johnston, it says here, furthermore, there is no evidence that these individuals charged with approving the claims check them for the consistency and provide corrective feedback where necessary. So, you know, I just wonder what kind of interrogations have been carried out by the Scottish Government, Mr. Johnston, to make sure that significant public funds that have been paid to ensure that this organisation is managed properly has actually been carried out.
I can certainly give an assurance that officials within the within the Directorate have been looking at claims, have been playing a scrutiny and challenge role with the police authority, and that has led to new processes.
So just ask in conclusion then, perhaps the committee could be provided with the necessary information concerning the number of claims that were made and the claims by which those individuals who received them as well. Because given the significant public funds, which I would expect around those figures, would have been expended in providing that information to the committee and for the public record.
Yes, we can certainly take that away and provide the information that the committee... Pardon?
Is information in the public domain at the moment?
I'm not immediately sure how much of it is in the public domain, but we can certainly provide the committee with the information that you're seeking.
Final question from David Thomas.
Thank you, Convener. Can I ask about the Scottish Police Authority's VAT liability of £26.7 million? And can I ask the panel and the new Chief Constable, in their previous experience, does any other police authorities in the UK pay that?
No, they don't.
Thank you.
No,
that's right.
Good time this morning, and now move to the next item. Can I just allow for a brief suspension before we move to the next item?
I wanted that on the record.
Of further response from the Scottish Government to the committee report entitled The Report on Scotland's Colleges 2015. Members will wish to be aware that the AGS report on Scotland's Colleges 2016 will be published this summer. Are members content to note this response, or do they have any comments? Mary Scanlon.
Convener, I think it's probably my fault that I didn't make myself clear at the time, but I find it, rather than getting a snapshot of figures for 1 year for student support, I would actually find it more helpful, if you don't mind, to ask for the trends of those figures, because I'd like, we hear so much that the figures are going up or going down. It would be helpful for this committee if we could get bursary, childcare and discretionary payments over, say, the past 5 years.
OK. Any other comments? Mark Griffin.
Thanks, Convener. I think if the committee are going to ask for further figures, I think it would be helpful as well to ask for details of the in-year payments, the top-ups to this budget. There are students that come to the end of the financial year, the budget spent, they're not sure if they're going to get the bursary for the last few months of the college term, and I think it would be worthwhile to ask the government why it is that year after year after year they make up these top-up payments rather than giving clarity to students at the start of the term.
Okay. Shubham Mullen.
Thank you. Just bearing in mind also the time that we have left in this session, I would recommend that we certainly put this onto the legacy paper for the next committee so that they could pick this up after the election.
Okay. Any other questions, points? So we can take on board the requests that have been made, and the clerks will prepare an addition to the legacy paper to ensure state of consideration. And we'll write to the Scottish Funding Council requesting the further information that both Mary Scanlon and Mark Griffin referred to. Okay, thank you. Can I move to agenda item number 5, which is settlement agreements. It's a report from the Scottish Government following a year of operation of the new arrangements. We are invited to agree to highlight our work in this area in the legacy paper and agree that the Scottish Government should continue to report annually with future reports addressed to Parliament and lodged with SPICE. Do members have any comments? I agree, Colin.
Ken McIntosh, who was quite vociferous in his calls for more openness, and I think, to be fair, Convener, we are getting more openness, but I would certainly welcome, although I won't be here, future reports to be addressed to the Parliament and to SPICE.
Okay. Thank you. Any other comments? Colleagues, as previously agreed, we now move to the next agenda item, which was agreed previously to hold in private. Then move into private session.